This is the story of Scandinavian Flight 751. On the 27th of December 1991, a Scandinavian MD-81 was to fly from Stockholm Arlanda Airport to Warsaw Chopin Airport with a stopover at Copenhagen. The plane landed at Stockholm at 10 p.m. the night before, after an almost two-hour flight from Zurich through the chilly air of Sweden. On the morning of the 27th, at 7:30 a.m., the mechanic who had to get the plane ready found that the underside of the wings were all iced up. If the underside of the wing were to be iced up, that means that the upper side could be iced up as well. He gets a ladder and feels the forward part of the top of the wing. He finds no ice, but does find slush, a mixture of ice and snow. He then went on to check the engine inlets for ice. The temperature was hovering around freezing or 0 degrees Celsius, so these checks were important. By 8:30 a.m., the plane was fueled up with 1,400 kilos or 3,000 pounds of fuel. The captain, in consultation with the mechanic, decided to de-ice the underside of the wing in addition to the upper side. Ice on an airplane's wings is incredibly dangerous as it changes the shape of the wing, and that can lead to the wings generating less lift on takeoff. At takeoff, a plane needs all the lift that it can get. The mechanics started to de-ice the top of the wing first. He sprayed de-icing fluid on the top of the wing, twice just for good measure. The 85 degrees Celsius or 185 degrees Fahrenheit fluid should have cleared away the ice, if any, that had accumulated. With the wings now clear of ice and snow, the pilots proceeded with the engine start. The captain asked the mechanic, "Good and clean under the wings?" The mechanic replied, "Yes, there was a lot of ice and snow. Now it's fine. It's perfect now." With the ice cleared away and the pre-start checklist done, the pilots taxied the MD-81 over to runway 08. With the plane lined up, the captain opened up the engines and the plane was on its way to becoming airborne. The plane lifted off at 8:47 a.m. local time, and almost immediately the passengers heard something in the back of the plane. It sounded like a low hum, but the sounds did not stop. The sounds grew worse. They could hear bangs and the aircraft seemed to be braking. The pilots could see that the right engine was struggling, and the first officer called out, "I think it's a compressor stall." The captain pulled back power on the right engine, but that did not solve the issue. The plane was climbing through 2,000 feet of altitude as all of this happened. 64 seconds after the plane took off, the left engine began to surge. 51 seconds after the first sign of trouble, the right engine had failed. 2 seconds later, so did the left engine. The plane was at 3,200 feet and was doing 196 knots. With no engines, the screens in the cockpit died. The crew relied on a small backup artificial horizon in the cockpit. 13 seconds after losing all power, the crew got a warning for fire in the left engine. They activated the fire suppressor in the left engine. A passenger flying on the plane was an off-duty SAS captain. Seeing that the plane was in trouble, he hurried to the cockpit to assist in any way that he could. The off-duty captain was tasked with bringing the APU, or the auxiliary power unit, online. The first officer let Stockholm Control know of their problems, and ATC let the crew know that runway 01 was available for them to land on. The captain says, "Prepare for an on-ground emergency." This was the cabin crew's cue to brace for an emergency landing. At 1,300 feet above the ground, the captain started to extend the flaps slowly. The assistant captain confirmed that the flaps had been fully deployed. At an altitude of about 900 feet, the plane broke through the clouds. The captain saw a field far off to the right, but it was too far away and there was no way that they'd reach it with the altitude that they had. He saw a field much closer to the plane and one which was in the general direction of flight. The pilots made the decision to land the plane there. As they got closer to the field, the pilot made slight corrections to turn the plane away from nearby houses. With them just 17 seconds from the ground, the first officer asked, "Shall we get the wheels down?" The captain responds with, "Yes, gear down." When they were 200 feet above the ground, they radioed Stockholm ATC. "Stockholm, SK-751, we are crashing to the ground now." 7 seconds later, the sound of the plane hitting trees was recorded on the CVR. As the plane plowed through trees, a part of its right wing was sheared off, inducing a slight right bank. The plane hit the ground with this right bank, tail first. The fuselage broke into three as it slid along the ground. But incredibly, all 129 people on board had survived the crash. Now, let's look at the actions of the pilots before and after the flameout to see exactly what it is that they did. The humming noise was heard in the cockpit and the pilots at first did not have any idea about what it was. When the first officer realized that the engine was surging, the captain pulled back power on the right engine. Amidst all of this, the design of the gauges in the cockpit were not working in the pilot's favor. The digital gauges were hard to read with the plane vibrating so much. In a study conducted in England, they found that almost half of the pilots surveyed found it hard to read digital gauges that were in use at the time. But despite this, they identified the problem correctly. Here is where the plane's auto-throttle system comes into play. The MD-81 has two, an ATS, an auto-throttle system, and an ATR, an automatic thrust restoration system. The ATR is designed to restore power to the engines should something go wrong. When the plane was climbing out and the engine started surging, the criteria for ATR to engage were fulfilled. The ATR was programmed to push the throttles to go around power, which makes sense if you have a loss of thrust on takeoff, you want as much power as you can get to climb out. But the ATR system worked in a special way. When it detected a loss in power, it pushed both throttles up to go around power. So after the captain had pulled back the throttles to deal with the surging engine, the ATR system pushed the throttles back up. In the event of a surge, you need to pull the throttles back so that the engine can recover from the surge. But in this case, the ATR system did the opposite. The crew was not trained on the ATR system, so they did not know that the plane would do this. After that, the captain did not consult a checklist, nor did he call for one. But even if he had started a checklist, it would have been of no use. The engines would have ripped themselves apart by the time he got to the first item. They did not have simulator training for an engine surge, and so the checklist was not memorized. Besides, if surges were not dealt with properly, it can rip an engine apart, and so pilots are taught to take action immediately to minimize damage to the engines, and that's what this crew did. After the engines failed, the off-duty captain entering the cockpit was technically a breach of conduct, but it turned out to be a good thing in the end. With the engines out of commission, the pilots were under a lot of stress, and the third person in the cockpit was instrumental in taking a lot of that pressure off of the pilots, allowing them to fly the plane and not worry about APU restarts. Now, let's talk about the engines. Examining the FDR data, they can see nothing wrong with the engines prior to rotation or takeoff. Engine surges can happen if the airflow to the engine is disrupted. A turbulent flow of air means that the engine cannot compress air properly, and that is bad for the engine. But looking at the data, they see that the N1, or the fan speed, go up by 4% on the left engine and by 6% on the right engine. This was accompanied by a reduction of thrust. Usually, when the N1 value goes up, your EPR, or thrust, goes up as well. This is abnormal. In addition to this, they find soft indentations on the fan blades of the engine. Something soft struck the engine as the plane lifted off. Broken bits from the engine were sent deeper into the engine, thereby damaging the engine more. The engine was so damaged that titanium alloys deep in the engine started burning. Friction and a copious supply of oxygen was all the engine needed for a titanium fire. But what had gotten into the engines that damaged it so badly? Windowside passengers can answer that. As the plane took off, they saw ice break off the top of the wings. Since the engines on the MD-81 are rear-mounted, the ice got sucked into the engines. The indentations on the fan blades indicated that something soft hit them, and ice fits the bill perfectly. The night before, when the plane flew in from Zurich, the air was cold, and during the flight, the fuel in the tanks were super chilled. With about 2,500 kilos or 5,000 pounds of fuel in each wing, the fuel cooled the upper surface of the wing, and the weather conditions were perfect for the formation of clear ice. That night, a mechanic had even noted that clear ice had formed on top of the wing. We knew that the wing had ice. That's why the captain ordered the plane to be de-iced. Had the ground crew done their job? The mechanics that were working on the plane had a checklist, and the checklist specified that they had to feel the upper surface of the wing, and they had to make sure that the wing was clear of ice. But the checklist did not specify how to proceed if clear ice was found on the wing. But the mechanics did do this. The mechanic climbed up a ladder, put one knee on the leading edge of the wing, and felt around for ice. He found none. Since this check wasn't standardized in any way, the mechanic wrongly assumed that there was no ice further down the wing. But all was not lost. They had one last line of defense. The upper side of the wing of the MD-81 was covered in tufts, which is basically string, something that can flap around in the wing. If there were to be clear ice, the tufts would be under the ice and therefore would not move during de-icing. The mechanic who de-iced the plane said that when he sprayed the de-icing fluid, he observed movement on one of the tufts. But passengers say that they saw no movements of the tufts during de-icing. The de-icing unit had missed some ice on the wing. With the cockpit being told that there was no ice on the wing, they went ahead with the takeoff. The danger of clear ice had been known since 1985, but the pilots weren't given any specialized clear ice training. According to procedures, the mechanics had to make sure that the wing was clear of ice by means of physical contact, and if the conditions were right for the formation of clear ice, they had to check for clear ice even if the first check turned up no ice. Moreover, a mechanic had observed clear ice the night before. This mechanic was in no way obligated to pass this information on to the mechanic who would be working on the plane in the morning. Even if they wanted to do a thorough inspection of the wing, they would need specialized ladders to check for ice, which they did not have. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. A big thank you to My Lost Airplane Fan for letting me use his amazing footage on my videos. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I'll catch you guys next time. Stay safe.